Ready, give it to go. Terrance, you first. Accio. Good. Bailey.
Accio.
Very good. Luke.
Accio.
Wonderful. Now Gretchen.
Accio.
Excellent. Now all together on the count of three. One, two, three.
Accio Hogwarts Radio.
This is Hogwarts Radio, episode 247 for July 14th, 2019. Hogwarts Radio is the official podcast for Wizarding News from HBA&A, discussing all things Harry Potter, Fantastic Beasts, and the rest of the Wizarding World. For the quickest up-to-date news on the franchise, make sure you check out wizarding.news. Welcome to episode 247 of Hogwarts Radio. I'm Terrence Pinkston.
I'm Bailey Riddle.
I'm Luke Hogan.
And I'm Alex Lohman.
Hogwarts Radio can be found anywhere you get your podcasts online. It doesn't matter where you listen, just be sure to click subscribe and you'll have a new episode as soon as it's released.
Make sure you follow the show on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram to get in on the fun with other listeners and fans of the series.
Don't forget, Hogwarts Radio is also on Patreon. By pledging, you'll receive instant access to bonus content, including behind-the-scenes planning of the show, Into the Common Room, Hogshead Radio, and much more.
This week's episode is brought to you by Patreon producer, the podcast That Family of Podcasts. Remember to sign up at patreon.com/Hogwarts Radio for your chance to become a producer of the show.
I know them.
I know them too. I'm so excited. Well, welcome.
You just can't hide it.
Thanks. I have the song in my head now. I was hoping somebody wouldn't finish that, but turns out Luke did. Oh, well, that's all
right. It feels like it's been so long since we've recorded an episode together.
In fact, for everybody out there, that we're going to kind of put some context here. So we were recording this episode. This is 247th edition. We were about an hour into the show, and suddenly the Dementors hit. And like we lost power everywhere, actually over on my end. So I lost power, lost the recording. So I'm like, oh my God, this is horrible. So that's
Hogwarts Radio demented.
That's yeah, exactly. That's stuff that you're not going to hear on the final production of, this particular episode, but that is stuff you will hear if you've been in the hangout with us for the past hour and a half, much like Sydney has. So thank you for sticking with us, Sydney. She's like,
Patreon bonus.
I feel like we've been here before. But anyway, so I was going through, much as I do, searching for topics to discuss, for the episode. And I came across this really interesting article over at MuggleNet. And it was worrying about the catermoles, how growing older has changed the way I read Harry Potter. And so the gist of the article was like finding different things in, or finding new things in a different light. Wait, did I say that right? Finding things, seeing things in a different light that you might not have seen before. And so that kind of made me think, well, the first time I read the series, I was 19 years old. I definitely see the world different now than I did then. So I'm kind of curious, Luke, how many times have you read the series?
There's really no number for that. It's a lot. It's weird to feel embarrassed about how many it is when you're on a Hogwarts Radio podcast. It's several hundred, and I don't feel like I'm exaggerating. I mean, you always hear about people, you know, reading like, oh, annually, you know, that they read the story, you know, all seven books, everything once a year. And I love that. That's amazing. There was a time where this was the only thing I read. And it was kind of like, oh, I finished. Well, let's go ahead and start again. And then it was, oh, audiobooks. That's even faster because it's not just me falling asleep. I can just keep going during the day while I'm driving. And so it's a lot. And it's become more and more as I've done a chapter by chapter podcast on it, because we do, you know, a chapter by chapter podcast where, you know, it's, you listen to it the first time just to refresh. Here's the overall idea. That's fine. And then you listen again, and okay, this is the Magicabulary. This is the first time we meet this character. These are the new locations we've been to. So more of the specifics. And then you're really primed to listen to that chapter again. So as I've been going through, I listen to every chapter 3, 4, 5 times, because there's also times where we're ready to record and then we don't record. And then 2 weeks later, we're like, okay, now we're going to record. So I did it all again. And so it's a lot. And even then, there are times where we're going through this chapter by chapter and you feel so stilted. I have to read everything right now just to get a full context, to have my narrow context make sense. It's weird. It's a lot.
I can imagine. Yeah. So this article by Megan Bidmead over at MuggleNet says, a lot has happened in my life since I last read the books, jobs and house moves, new friendships blossoming and others fading. The most significant change, though, was parenthood. I wasn't prepared for how much being a parent would inform my reading of Potter, other than giving me an excellent opportunity to read them. I mean, I cared deeply about Mr. and Mrs. Weasley before I had kids. I cared about them when I was a kid, but there was something about Molly's Boggart this time that made me cry. Never cried at that moment before, at Molly watching her worst fear come to life in front of her. I found it harrowing, of course, but I never cried. So definitely a bigger, a more different perspective, even for myself, reading the books and the lessons that they've taught me throughout the years. And this is something that we'll get into later on in the show. But the community itself has really opened my eyes to different views of the world. And it's helped me build accepting relationships with people of many backgrounds and break out of my own social shell.
Yeah, I think, viewing the series differently, at least for me, it's come to more at least appreciating some of the, you could call them like the B-plot characters, the characters who are kind of in the constants in the background, who are really looking out for Harry the entire time, who weren't necessarily like Sirius Black or, you know, Harry's parents in some emotionally spiritual supportive way. But, you know, I'm thinking like the Professor McGonagall's of the world, that, you know, as an adult who looks out for kids, I can so appreciate how much she fought for him and how much Harry never really appreciated it, but she kept doing it the whole way through. And I can definitely, you know, see that now. And it's interesting to not only realize like these subtle details when rereading and noticing, you know, new connections, but just a new appreciation for like the emotional bandwidth of some of these characters that, you know, more often than not, we don't give enough credit for how much they did for Harry throughout the series.
Yeah, I think as I've grown up and kind of understood more about people in general, I really respect how this series portrays Harry going through all of these hard things in his life, and he still manages to do a decent job at just growing up and being a kid. But it's made me realize that you never know what someone is going through, and you can never judge just based off of your perspective from the outside until you actually are in the situation. You don't know how you'll handle it.
That really makes me think of a distinct example in the books, where in book 4, where Ron, basically Harry gets chosen as Triwizard champion, and Ron kind of outcasts his friendship from Harry because of that, and there's jealousy involved. And it's one of those things that, looking at it now, you know, as an adult, I see both sides. Harry and Ron in that vein are exactly correct for their perspective. They're both right. It's easy to look from Harry's perspective when you're reading for the first time and say, why is Ron being such a jerk right now? But he has every right to be upset with Harry, even because he has no idea what's going on. And he does have his own personal demons and jealousies to deal with. And until you have that ability to step yourself out and back a bit, it makes you think, why is Ron being such a jerk? But I don't know. I think both sides are completely valid.
Well, like you guys said, you never know what somebody's going through until you've actually experienced what they're going through. You know, not many people in this series can relate to the loss of a parent. Neville would be the closest to Harry, at that point. But even so, he physically still has them there. But I mean, of course, they're mentally not there. Their capacity is just gone. It's out the window. And that in a sense has to make it harder for, you know, that particular situation. Sure, Harry doesn't have his parents, but Neville has his parents, and they're unable to reciprocate any kind of feeling towards him. So that's you never know what people, what, you know, you never know what somebody's going through until you've kind of been in their situation before. Let's move on to another topic here. And this one is, well, since the last time that we've released an episode, a little game has come out called Wizards Unite. And now that we've had a couple of weeks to kind of get into the game, want to discuss some of the things that we have been seeing, some of the likes, dislikes, and all that other stuff. Like, I'll kick it off. For example, I like that you can collect different things at different places in the city. I also like that you can go to particular businesses for specialized items. Like, I was at PetSmart the other day for magizoology items, which is really cool. And my dog was walking me through PetSmart because I was too busy catching these confoundables. But I just kind of like that diversity. Like, thank goodness. Like, I mean, unless you're stuck in like one particular place all the time, you know, you're going to pick up different things as you go. Like if you go to the mall, or if you go to the, you know, grocery store, or you're going to go to the hospital, even there's things in there. So I kind of like that the game is diverse in that aspect.
You know, it's funny you mentioned picking up certain items in certain places, because now that I'm thinking about it, every time I go to the bank for work, there's one of those little like flags that pops up and says, more dark arts items can be found here in the city block where the bank is at. And I'm liking the symbolism of that one.
That's a little on the nose, maybe.
A little bit. I guess one of my favorite and least favorite things is there's some areas in my town, like a downtown for instance, that there's a lot of inns and greenhouses, and there's just lots of things to see and pick up in certain areas of town. But in the same vein, when you're out in the less populated or less shopping developed, let's say, areas of town, there's not as much to do. So I wish that things were more equally dispersed amongst areas so that you're not having to go to the highly populous areas of your town.
So one of the major things that I've heard so far about this game is the location. And one of our good friends, Sydney, is just fed up. She's upset because she can't really play this game in the rural area that she's in. There's literally nothing around her. Maybe an inn or a fortress, but those are, you know, a good distance away from where her physical location is. And I've even experienced it myself going up to visit family and not having roads around me, but not having literally anything. I mean, I just open it up and it's just my character sitting there and looking out at nothing, looking out at the sky or something like that. So, I mean, I definitely feel that frustration, that aspect of it. Like, you're not able to collect certain items. You're not able to play the game. You're all out of energy. You know, and the only thing for you to do to keep kind of playing the game is to purchase the items. And I could see that as a real big turnoff for a lot of people.
So as we're recording, I pulled my phone up to show that there's nothing around my house. I'm not in a very rural area in St. Louis, Missouri. You might think it's flyover country. That's fine. But as I pulled my phone up, I thought it was very funny that it said, you're going too fast. I'm sitting in my basement. It says, you must be driving. So I told it I'm a passenger, so it's fine. But yeah, my overall issues with the game, I've had a lot of fun playing it, running out of energy and also being full on inventory on everything, potions, ingredients, potions themselves. I really feel like it's forcing me to try to spend money, and I won't. I will not spend money on a mobile game. That's just not what I'm going to spend my money on. I think it's a well-developed game. I think they've done a good job creating a fun game. I should get out and walk more. Yes, that's true. But I also don't think that I should be completely locked out of the game because I am, one, out of potion space, two, out of inventory space for potion ingredients. I can't even retrieve the potions that I've created, which I'm also out of energy. The only place you can use potions is when you're at a gym, or I shouldn't say gym, that's the Pokemon Go term for it, at an inn or a, what do they call them? What do they call them here? I haven't been to one.
Fortress.
I've been to one, but I was out of energy, so I couldn't do it, which is very, very frustrating. Personally, I'm trying to play the game, and I feel like I am limited, and I'm very much with our good friend Sydney of, even if you're trying to play the game, it kind of shuts you out if you're not willing to pay. And I don't know if that's in the spirit of the Harry Potter community and story, personally.
You know, it's kind of interesting. You know, I'm thinking about the comments that you guys are making about having access to, like, finding things when you're living in rural areas. Paying for things, refusing to pay for things to try and sew on that team. I'm kind of wondering if there's, like, any real claim to say that there's kind of like a discrimination issue that's going on with the game, based on the fact that it's really only actually playable for those who live in more kind of developed metropolis areas. Yeah. And then not only that, but you have more rural areas, which more often than not, more rural areas are lower in socioeconomic status. And you're asking those people to then financially contribute to have the same advantages as people who probably, right. And so part of me was like, and there's like a whole sub legal theory, like, discussion going on in my brain right now about how this would actually work. I'm kind of interested to dig around to see if people had the same issues with Pokemon Go. And if so, like, if anyone was floating this conversation, because you've been talking about it a lot. And admittedly, I haven't played the game all that much because I swear I just have undiagnosed ADHD and I just forget all the time. My brain's always like squirrel, but with like 50 things going on in my life. And I'm also frustrated that I have chubby fingers and cannot trace the spells correctly. And it's always like, oh, you did a bad job. But
you knew Alohomora was so difficult, right?
Yeah. I mean, I feel like the town I live in is rather small. And I mean, comparatively to LA, it is. But we still have a population of 150,000 people. So we are by no means a small town.
Neither is St. Louis.
Exactly. Granted, you're further out from city center and directly in downtown, which could possibly have something to do with it, but
so concentrated,
discriminatory against people who are not in highly populated areas.
I mean, I have friends that say, oh, I can sit on my couch and there's an inn right next to me, so I don't even have to get up and I can sit here and play the game like that, you know, and still collect energy. But I have, you know, other people that are in the same boat as most of the panel here. We really have to walk a couple of miles to the next inn or drive. You know, you never know what, you know, true love is until you, what was that quote I saw on Twitter?
So my cousin, she recently started playing this game and she's, she doesn't want to walk around to play it. She's not feeling too well right now. And so she, every weekend, has talked her husband into driving her around so she can play this game. And I said, you know, you've seen true love when your husband is willing to drive you around so you can play Wizards Unite.
That is true love.
That was amazing. And shout out to the Twitter account who then tagged all of our significant others in that. My husband felt so seen. He was like, Alex, Hogwarts Radio tweeted at me. I made a tweet. I was so excited about it.
Yeah.
On a like kind of related but not note, we were talking about like being on coast and if you have an advantage or not. So devil's advocate here, I don't know if it really is an advantage. And I messaged this to the Slack chat a couple weekends ago, right after the game first came out. I love to paddleboard. I go paddleboarding on the weekends. and I had like a little wet dry bag and or a dry bag that I put on my board so I can keep my phone and stuff on me. So I like paddled to this little inlet and I'm like, oh my God, there's probably some really cool things that if I open my app in the middle of the ocean right now, I'll be able to see. Zilch. Nada. Nothing. I was like, seriously? I worked so hard to paddle my butt out here and there is nothing. So there's no coastal advantage, my friend.
I would have expected like a kelpie or something out there in the ocean.
Yeah, no. I mean, the coast of Florida is barren, unfortunately.
Wow. You know, I would expect like certain items to be found on beaches as well. You know, nifflers and coins and beaches and shiny stuff. I don't know. I mean, so overall gameplay, I mean, I've been enjoying it myself. Yes, I'm one of those people that gets in my car and drives to the nearest inn or the fortress just
at
to collect
9 miles an hour.
Seven. It doesn't collect unless you go under seven.
Hey, I've made it to 15 and it still hasn't flagged me.
What up? So
I was sitting in my basement a minute ago and it flagged me.
So the game has some bugs to work out.
It does. But I mean, overall satisfied with the gameplay. I mean, yeah, the inventory levels are frustrating, but that's why I've been going in and deleting a lot of the potions items because some of the challenges are pick up a potion item, use a potion, pick up an ingredient, and it gives you energy for or coins for completing these tasks as well. So that's what I've been, you know, kind of doing each day is going through my inventory. Maybe I'll just go clear it all out because it didn't take hardly any time to get a full inventory of potions and ingredients, you know, and that way I have now at least the ability to pick up things that I see. So that'll be a little bit.
In talking about this, that truly was new information to me, that part of my limitation was I couldn't pick new things up to even get the extra energy. So thank you.
You're welcome.
I will figure that out and or ask Bailey to show me how to delete ingredients that I have.
Yeah, it is pretty simple. And I forgot, you know, mostly like I forget how to do it and I forget to do it. And I just get frustrated and I drive to the next place or I walk to the next area to collect. And then I'm stupidly pushing the button again and saying, oh, let me pick up this ingredient. Oh, damn it. I'm full again. Okay. But, you know, I found myself to kind of dwindle down my potions inventory to use my potions at least or delete some of them that I'm not going to use that I haven't used. So, I mean, inventory control is definitely a big thing here. And I'm one of the people that will spend money on this game, but I will not spend money on making my bag bigger. I will spend money on energy, which does set me apart from a lot of folks. But, you know, if I can get 100 coins for 99 cents and those 100 coins gets me, you know, 50 energy and I'm able to, you know, play the game for another hour or so in an area that I'm not, you know, that doesn't have an inn. Yeah, I'm going to do that. I did recently go to Mexico and I got the two country badge. It was pretty cool, but I didn't get it until I came back into the United States. So
that is pretty surprising.
Yeah. I'm kind of like, you know, is that a bug? You know, what if I don't come back? That's, you know, will I still get the badge?
Yeah. So, like, do you have to like go back home? Or like, if I just every time I say that, oh, I'm gonna go to Ireland, I say I'm probably not gonna come back, so I might not ever get the two country thing. If I go to Ireland first, I might just be out of luck.
Will we keep playing it? That's the big question.
Absolutely. I play it every single day and I find it's where I live, it's convenient to play it as a passenger in the car or keep it open while I'm driving and play it when I get to a stoplight. So I think that for me, it's a convenient game to play and I will continue to play it.
I will overall agree. It's to me, it's a much more long-term play than it's. Let's go ahead and talk about the elephant in the room, the Hogwarts mystery. To me, it's a lot more playable and replayable and continuing playable than Hogwarts Mystery. And I did not dislike Hogwarts Mystery. It just was too stop and go for me. It again forced me to stop. At least this, I'm learning there are ways I can actively choose without paying money only to kind of carry my own play fate, if you will, in this game. And it really stinks. And I think it's also incredibly unfortunate that our good friends like Sydney are completely in the dark. No matter how many miles or kilometers they walk, no matter how often they have the app open, they're still stuck in the dark, you know? And that's, to me, that's frustrating. And I'll keep playing. I'm not going to spend hours on it, but I'll open it up here and there. And I'll, like I said last time we were on here, I'll go out with my 5-year-old and have him do much more dexterous things than I can do on the screen. And it's going to be fun for us to be able to do walking around together. But much more than that, no.
So I like it more than Hogwarts Mystery. And the reason why I like it more is because I don't have to sit around and wait for my energy to come back to me. You know, I don't have to. Yeah. Yeah. Luke is agreeing with me here on the camera. I don't think it's right to have 7 hours. Like, you have to wait for like 5 energy to come back for 7 hours. And
it's so funny you mentioned that. I opened up Wizards Unite over the weekend Hogwarts Mystery, trying to get back into it. And I had to complete the same task 4 times over before I finally finished it because I kept forgetting that I was almost done with it.
Uh-huh.
I'm over it. You're punished for not playing it,
and you're punished for not being able to just dedicate every 3.5 hours.
Yeah, like, oh, let me set my alarm so I can remember to go finish this activity. No, that's not going to happen.
So I really like the story in Hogwarts Mystery much more than I like the story in Wizards Unite. It's just playing Hogwarts Mystery is just so damn frustrating. It really is. Playing Wizards Unite is something I can actively do on the go. It's very savvy with the AR. Like tech savvy with the AR, which you can toggle off, right, Bailey? You have that's kind of like one of your hacks.
Yes, that is one of my hacks for the game. I was noticing as I was walking around that, like, when you're using the AR and you find a foundable that you want to save, if you are using the AR, you have to be standing in exactly the same spot that you discovered it once you found the magical traces, which, you know, if you're walking from your car into the store, you're not going to stop in the middle of the parking lot and try to save
this
foundable.
It's not.
Yeah.
My hack is, if you turn off the AR, you can just tap on the icon that shows you, hey, there's a Care of Magical Creatures item over here. And it automatically brings you to the foundable that needs to be saved. So you don't have to be location-based as much.
And my follow-up, as being someone who on this show hates spending money unnecessarily, if you pay for data and or are tired of your battery dying, here are a couple other quick pro tips. When you're on your main Wizards Unite page where you can see your little character avatar on the map, if you click your suitcase, top left button, there's 2 little cogs there that'll bring you to your settings. If you go to your settings, you can turn music off, you can turn sound effects off. The music, sound effects, they're brilliant. I love them. But if you're strapped for battery, I recommend turning them off just in those conditions. You can also adjust your notifications. You can also adjust the way your camera reacts. You can turn AR off in general right there, so you don't have to turn it off specifically each time a confoundable comes up. The advanced features, I think, are where the real benefit comes in the way they developed this app. They allow you to turn on a battery saver mode, which is awesome. They also allow you to turn on, probably my favorite thing, download all assets.
What does that mean?
As someone who pays for data, I hate paying for data. I like 99% of the time, I'm on Wi-Fi. If I'm on Wi-Fi, awesome. Great. That's cool. I'll pay for that. But if I'm out and about and you want to reduce the data usage you have, download all assets, and then you're just relying on geolocation data being spent. I think it's a great benefit that they offer that, and good on them for having that as an option.
So it downloads everything in the game?
It took a while. In all honesty, it took a little while for it to download all assets. It was like 1,900 something items. I don't know what that includes. Like, I would love to have the option of digging into it and seeing, like, oh, each individual screen or item or element that was included, just to see what that includes. But regardless, I will give you an update if it truly diminishes the data output required by the game next week.
Well, yeah, what you can do is you can turn your data off, your cellular data off, and go and play the game, go out and about in the community and play the game and see if it truly, you know, gives you those same pop-ups, the same confoundables, or if it's just like select items that you can only get through that massive download dump, you know, or if you have to be on cellular for them to, you know, say, oh, you know what, we put a Hogwarts confoundable right over here in this park, you know, and it wasn't there whenever you downloaded everything. So that's what I can see being different.
Yeah, and I know this episode typically comes out on Sunday. I will test this out as this episode comes out this weekend in Nashville. Bailey and I will be in Nashville this weekend, and I will test it out directly compared to hers and see if there's any difference. We'll give you a side-by-side comparison. Maybe we'll make that a little Patreon incentive video right there.
Cool stuff. Yeah, I am going to keep playing it, and I'm going to keep spending money on energy. I mean, that's just my thing. To be fair, I've had so much going on that I haven't opened the app in probably a week. But I, you know, plan on getting back to it this weekend and having a lot of fun doing it, because it's not that I've stopped playing because I dislike the game. It's just like so many things happening all at once right now, and I'm really looking forward to spending some time just getting back into the game and casting spells and catching things. Let's talk about what could make it better. What do we think? I mean, as far as like, you know, Pokemon Go has a lot of accessories, my understanding. It has a watch app, which I could see being incredibly useful for Wizards Unite game, especially whenever you're walking and it ties into your health app of your, like, how many steps you take and all that other stuff. I could see maybe, like, having, like, a wand accessory, a Bluetooth wand accessory, where you're casting spells. You have to cast the Alohomora spell, or you have to cast, you know, whatever spell you have to use to catch your confoundable. I could see that being like a big moneymaker for them as well. Like you had said earlier, Luke, there's plenty of ways they can make money with this game, and these are, you know, just a couple of different ways they can utilize that.
Can I say, having bought an interactive wand from Universal, if there was a way to connect those together, I think I'd be way better at the spells than tracing them on the screen. I'm going to say I'm a wandsman. You know, I feel like my talents lie in wand work. I love wand lore. It's kind of a thing. And I feel like I do a lot better if I could use the utensil for the job than tracing. As Alex was saying, chubby fingers on a screen is different than using a wand that is built for the job.
But Luke, with your fingers, you know what they want you to do? They want you to go out and buy a bigger phone. I don't know. I can maybe see Bailey. Cool Bailey's right now. She's, oh, I thought she was playing the game. No, she's actually doing something else. But I was like, oh, she's casting spells. All I can see is her hand going up and down, up and down. I'm like, oh.
No, I'm chopping paper. I've been chopping paper for 3 days straight.
Fun stuff.
My arm has just become part of the paper chopper.
I thought she was, I was like, oh my God, she's really good at this, like, Aloha Morse spell. I was like, what are you doing?
No, there is absolutely nothing around me to see.
Yeah.
It's just empty.
Yeah, looking at your phone right now, and there's nothing. You can see the streets and stuff like that. And I mean, same thing here. At least with Pokemon Go, there was a Pokemon that popped up, like, maybe in the backyard over here, or maybe in the front of the house, the street.
To be fair, every once in a while, if I open the app, there is something that's like right in front of my house that I can catch easily. But I would say out of 7 days in the week, that might happen once.
Zero for Luke, zero for me, and zero for Sydney as well, who's watching us record this second take of our episode 247 this evening. Is there anything else that you guys want to talk about with Wizards Unite? Is there anything that we should discuss? I'm sure there's going to be more things to talk about in the future as we dig through the game.
No, I think it's good. Overall, I think it's a good game. There are changes that I wish it would make, but I don't mean this as any bashing on it. Truly, I think it's a well-developed game. The technology is solid.
All right, so that does wrap up with our Wizards Unite stuff here, and Alex does have to go. So sorry, it was a short evening for you, Alex. Actually,
I'm sorry, guys.
That's okay. She has very, very important grown-up stuff to do later on.
Like sleep.
Yeah. We don't know what that is over here.
Oh, bless you folks. I don't know how you do it, but yes, unfortunately, I gotta hit the hay.
West of you is how we do it.
Yeah.
That is fair.
We've been putting our brains together, and we have some good stuff about mental health coming up. So
very excited about it.
Definitely so. Okay, Alex, we'll let you go. Have a good evening. Get some sleep.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Bye.
Here's something we hadn't talked about in quite a while, and I thought it would be fun to revisit it, but not a fun topic by any means, but were there any deaths in the series that surprised you guys? Anything that kind of really knocked your socks off? Oh, Dobby. Oh, socks, Dobby. I'm so sorry, Dobby.
Too soon, Terrence.
Too soon.
I'm staring
sorry.
At no. 10-inch tall Funko Pop Dobby right now.
Yeah.
I missed the puns. The great opportunities there. Give me it again. One more time. No, that's really good. Deaths that knocked our socks off. Other than Dobby for sock puns, gotta walk past that one now. I don't know. The things that kind of stand out to me again is kind of, I'm thinking of the previous question of things that you think differently about now than the first time you read it. And something that doesn't really stand out differently to me is like Tonks and Lupin, when they died, it's so in the background and nonchalant that, like, for two very, very lovable characters, you kind of don't care at that point. Is it just me? Like, is it just me on that? Like, to me, it's so off, like, such an offhand comment that, oh, Harry's walking through and they're just dead. Like, you don't really have a chance for it to weigh in. It thoughts on that? I don't mean to change the subject at all, but like it to me, it's more like the opposite, I guess. Of it, kind of meant nothing to me at that point.
Because we didn't. Do you feel that way because we didn't see what happened? We didn't see the actual moment they were struck with their individual curses.
Partially, I do think that has a part to it, but also because there was so much more emotional tension for what Harry was going through in that moment. There's so much death and there's so much turmoil that it's just par for the course. You know, it's not to say that it wasn't valiant or gallant or anything or valuable of any sort for why they died or how they died. Like, that's, I don't mean to diminish their sacrifice at all. It's emotionally resonant. It kind of falls flat for me compared to, say, a George Weasley, where we do see it. And compared to even
Fred.
Sorry. Yeah. Fred Weasley, because George is the good one. So he lives. Anyway, even like the Creevies, where I don't know, like, it's even the Dennis and Colin Creevy, I feel differently about than I do Tonks and Lupin. And maybe that's because they're so innocent and they're so gung ho, let's go for it, and maybe not thinking through it all clearly, where both Tonks and Lupin literally went in knowing that they were going to be probably having a chance to sacrifice themselves. I don't know. Maybe I'm overthinking it, but it's always felt those two to me, I felt, should have been more emotionally resonant than they were.
So the death of Fred absolutely gutted me. I felt that was a senseless death. There was no need for it. His character was meant to show us that nobody was immune from what was happening at the time. No family was immune from what was happening at the time. And my argument with that was like, yeah, because we totally didn't get the magnitude of what was going on. We had to have that one more death at the very end there because we hadn't experienced the death of a beloved character before. I just felt like that was a senseless death. We've already been through like loss with the Order. So I don't know why she chose to get rid of him in particular.
Yeah, I think the death that really, not even surprised me the most, but kind of set the tone for how Deathly Hallows was going to go was Mad-Eye. That, to me, was just, oh, we're getting into it, and we're starting early, and no one is safe.
I kind of felt
like Game of Thrones.
I remember thinking, whenever Mad-Eye died, the only thing I could think was like, oh my God, this is going to be a bloodbath. Because at that point, we had already lost Hedwig, and Mad-Eye was next. And it's like, oh my God, that shows you, that sets the tone for the book and how really nobody was going to be safe. Not the one of the greatest Aurors of all time. And Voldemort just totally got rid of him like yesterday's news. So I'm just, there were deaths that were necessary, sure. But for me, Fred was just not a necessary death. All right, let's move on to the news this week. Very slow news month, but there are a couple of pieces to discuss. The Hagrid ride was closed the other day at Universal Studios, and as I was going through Instagram and Twitter, people were posting pictures of the sign that it was not in operation for that particular day. Now, we reported on the previous episode that they were going to have delayed openings for the ride. They needed to make sure that the operational checks were done properly. They needed to make sure that the safety inspections were happening and that they were really, they painted a picture that this ride was being pushed beyond its original capacity. So that's why they wanted to take, you know, great care with that. But I've got to ask, they closed it for an entire day and they've had delayed openings since then. What exactly is the issue?
As someone who has not been on the ride, has not waited in the 6-8 hour line, just someone who works in a design industry, I'll say that, this truly feels like poor planning and poor design to me. And I hate saying that because I love this company. I love this fandom. I love this community, and it feels rushed, I think, is maybe the best word for it. And we've been hearing about this for a while, so much so that it doesn't feel rushed, right? I mean, if you're just checking in every once in a while, we started talking about this in October, if I remember correctly, of, hey, they're going to shut down this ride and they're going to start promoting this other ride. that was only 6-8 months ago. That's not that long ago, but it just seems like the design development has not kept up with a realistic capacity for what the demands on the ride would be. I am not an amusement park expert. I am not a roller coaster designer expert, but I am surprised by this lack of performance. I think is the best way to say it. If there was that high of a worry factor in the maintenance of it within 3 weeks of it opening, am I wrong on that? It was like about 3 weeks into it that they started limiting ride time due to maintenance issues. And now 6 weeks, 7 weeks into its operation, they're closing it down for a whole day. I feel like there's a design flaw. I not that there's a safety issue. I don't mean to like throw any scare tactics out there. I don't think it's unsafe. I think it's maybe inefficient. And to me, that's just surprising.
What's even more surprising for me is, and I think we mentioned this last week, there was no soft opening for this ride whatsoever.
Yeah, absolutely. That's why. Like, why not?
It's because they wanted to show that they could go full steam with it. You know, they could.
They can't.
Well, yeah. I mean, obviously, they're having all these issues, and my whole thing with this was, well, the ride operates for, let's say, 12 hours a day. You know, there's 12 hours that it does not operate, and that is the time that could be used to run these checks, these safety inspections, provide the maintenance on the ride. I failed to understand why they are having it closed for 16, 17, 18, all the way to 20 hours sometimes. Mm-hmm. It's just, it doesn't make sense to me. What Luke said does really kind of shed a lot of light. Yeah, it was a rushed project. It was only like, 6 to 8 months between closure of Dueling Dragons, total demo of Dueling Dragons, clearing the area, and the building of this ride, because it did go up very, very fast.
Mm-hmm. And I think you have to think of it as a park goer. I mean, there are plenty of people who planned entire vacations around this ride opening.
I like Universal for my experience with Universal, but Disney does it better. And Disney is truly the creme de la creme. Like, they are it in amusement parks. And My question to you guys, who are much more on top of this than I am, has Disney ever had a ride flop like this, a ride opening flop like this? I have never heard of it, but I'm also not in that game.
Yeah, I don't think so. And I'm going to make the easiest comparison right now and compare the opening of Hagrid's Magical Motorbike Adventure to the opening of an entire land at Disneyland, Galaxy's Edge, and they have the Millennium Falcon ride. And as far as I've heard, that's gone swimmingly. I don't think there's been any issue with the lines. It's been very clear from the beginning that, you know, even if you want to get into this land, you're going to have a set time frame that you can do it if you had a reservation in that first couple week period. Now it's freely open, and I think anyone who goes to the park can go in it. But for that entire first month, you had to have a specific reservation to go in so that they could control the just not only the traffic in the land itself, but the traffic on the ride. And I think that Universal still has a lot to learn.
And I think that really is where the nature of it just feels rushed to try to catch up as a player in the game that feels like it's behind. That's kind of how I feel about it as a non-expert looking in, I'll say.
Well, see, and that's also, Disney has had a long time to, you know, to kind of fine tune everything. The first Disneyland park opened in 1958? I believe it was. And so, you know, that first day, it's my understanding that the Pirates of the Caribbean ride, everything that went wrong went wrong in that park. Absolutely. On that particular day.
Yeah.
But you know what? Since then, I can't think of a particular instance where things have gone wrong. Sure, rides have been shut down. You know, the older rides like Space Mountain is not operating today. I mean, sure, to be expected, but not 6 weeks.
60 years.
Not 6 weeks into the opening of the ride. I mean, that's a little bit ridiculous. The only other ride at Disney that I can think of that may be giving like a bit of trouble is Fast Track. And Fast Track is where you go in, you design your own vehicle, and you actually sit in the vehicle. It's and you test drive it all the way through like various elements and stuff.
Test track.
Test track. There you go. Yeah.
Isn't that what he said? That's what he said.
No, I said Fast Track.
That's the
highway toll system in California.
Yeah, there you go. But that one has constant issues that are wrong with it, but I can't think of anything else, you know, Disney related that really has any trouble. So, but Universal, I have no doubt that Universal will get there. I'm surprised they didn't implement a virtual queue for this ride because the ride was over 10 hours long. As far as the wait time, whenever it initially opened, it's gone down. I think, the other day it was 150 minutes, which is about 2.5 hours. So, I mean, it's slowly working its way down, but you're also, remember, you're in the peak season for, you know, tourists and stuff like that. People that want to visit the park are visiting it more in the summer than they are any other time of the year.
I really still think if they're not showing the Harry Potter movies in the queue, that's an opportunity lost. When you have multiple hours standing there, you got to have a narrative, right?
A little bit. Next, final news story here relates back to Wizards Unite, and Wizards Unite is having its first fan festival happening over Labor Day weekend, August 31st through September 1st, and it's going to be held in White River State Park in Indianapolis. Now, what does this include? Everybody's like, yeah, fan festival. What is that? Everybody playing around, standing around playing the game?
What does that include?
Everybody standing around playing the game. Well, kind of. You have to purchase a ticket for it. And the way that Pokemon Go does theirs is that ticket holders can expect to look forward to a, you know, packed weekend of special events, exclusive rewards, and maybe even get sneak peeks or learn new secrets about the game. On the article on MuggleNet, it says, going by the description of the event, it is clear that all the attendees will have access to a number of interactive adventures that will merge the in-game experience with its real-world setting. Many players will have largely played the game by themselves until the festival, so this will present an incredible opportunity for them to meet other players as they fight to solve the calamity that threatens to expose the magical world. I'm sure that Niantic has learned from last time, whenever they first launched these festivals for Pokemon Go, they didn't have the infrastructure in place to be able to support that. I think they had maybe enough for like 20,000 people, but it was right in Millennium Park in Chicago, so you have 20,000 people around the area anyway. But it was just like the cell infrastructure crashed. People weren't able to play the game, but they were just still happy to be there and meeting up with each other. So I'm just kind of curious, like, have they learned from this? Do they expect, like, what kind of turnout do they expect? Obviously, this is Harry Potter. This is very big.
That's interesting. I don't live terribly far from Indianapolis. I just drove through there earlier this spring to go to Ice and Fire Con for Game of Thrones. And from St. Louis, Indianapolis, it's 4 or 5 hours. It's not a bad drive. Not terribly far. I don't know what this has to offer. Like, is it really worth making a trip. I don't know. I like the idea, I think, is my overall feeling of it. And I really hope, as Bailey was talking earlier about, of if the interactivity between players can increase before then, I think this could be a truly incredible thing. Like, that could be really, really awesome, as opposed to, oh, we're all a bunch of individuals in the same place. That's what I don't want it to be.
And see, that's all I see it being. Sure, there might be special things that Niantic throws out there that you can collect, and, you know, certain confoundables that you might be able to find there that you can't find anywhere else. However, the interactive piece of this game just, I mean, I don't want to jump back into Wizards Unite, but it really bothers me because you can send your friends a friend code and they can accept it. But, like, what do you do? Like, what can you do with your friends to kind of bring out this interaction as you go through and accomplish tasks throughout the game? The only thing that I'm able to think of, and me and my wife have done this, we'll drive to a fortress. And you have to, in a fortress, you have to battle certain elements, like certain Death Eaters, and you get a, you know, you get a prize at the very end of it. But you don't do it together. It's like you can see the other person there, but you're not actively like two against one. You know, it's like I'm fighting my own guy and she was fighting her own guy. You know, it was on that level. So I'm like, okay, so what are they expecting? Like, is it a new feature they haven't rolled out yet where I can like feed you energy, Luke? Like, am I able to just say, hey, you know what, I have like 100 energy and I need to give 50 to Luke, like, go ahead and transfer.
I hope so. Praise the seven. I sure hope that that's a thing.
The old dogs in the dude.
That's true. I do feel like social gaming should be at the crux of any game nowadays. I got into video games before social online gaming was a thing. So I've been not the most user beneficent person that's been in mobile gaming, because it's just different than how I grew up with the games. But for me, if I am going to have a mobile game, it should be very collaborative. It shouldn't be necessarily only competitive by score or individualistic. And I really do think that the strength in getting into this fandom, into this community, is identity as a part of the community and not necessarily promoting hyper insulated individualism, which so far it seems to be the case. But if they could really promote working together, not being judgmental on who everyone is, which I think they do a fair job of being on that. But one of the major tenets of the story, the narrative itself, are everyone's equal. Everyone has a part to play. And right now, I feel like, again, we keep referencing our good friend Sydney, but she is completely locked out of the game because of where she is geographically. And to me, that truly is a big detriment to supporting the game in that regards. I feel bad that certain people have a bigger benefit for their geographical location only to have any fun or success playing the game.
Yeah, I feel like it would be really cool if at some point, maybe at this festival that they launch it, but that you could like team up with people to defeat tougher confoundables and the more challenging ones, the rarer ones. So say you and your friend are in the same area, the more rare confoundables are going to pop up. I think that would be a great addition to the game.
Yeah, absolutely. And like, if you think about it narratively, like, say you're a very high level, right? You're for what you can be right now, there's another one of our patrons, Michael, Ravenclaw Michael, who's a level 16, almost 17, yeah, right
he's
now.
He's even higher than I am.
he's way up there. And like, what challenges does that person have right now? And are there benefits to having friends that are that high level that can kind of up somebody that can't have those opportunities? Like, again, to me, like, the collaboration and playability between friends, not just geographical, but also, hey, I have so many X number of people that have friended me within the app. I feel like I should be able to ping, you're my friend, let's do this together. There should be interactivity between my avatar and somebody else's avatar, regardless of geolocation. I'm not saying that's easy to do computer science wise, but I think it should be an option.
Yeah, and another thing that just popped into my head as I was checking to see what level I was in the game, level 12 for anyone 12. Who is interested.
12. She's 12.
But I wish that the daily challenges would change every day. I'm sick of doing the same 7 things over and over again to complete my daily challenge. I want some variety, you know, go find something in this foundable family or go,
Especially as your level increases, it seems like that should get more difficult
or adding more things to have to finish. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that could use
clearly
a little
you're
tweak.
Motivated to do them and you mm-hmm. like you can do them. So it should be more challenging and more rewarding. But who asked me? Nobody.
No, I completely agree with you on all aspects. So we'll just have to see as time goes on and Niantic starts to add more things to this game, if those, in fact, are going to be some of the things that we're able to do and if they are able to change up, you know, some of these daily challenges. It'd be interesting to watch for. All right, let's move on to our next segment here. This is our Road to LeakyCon segment, and this week we're going to be discussing time management. So with so many things to see, so many lines to stand in, how do you make sure that you see everything that you want to see? And how do you do everything that you want to do? I'm going to defer over to Bailey, who is our veteran con goer of this panel here. And you, both you guys are actually getting ready to go to a con this weekend.
Exactly. As this episode releases, we will be in Nashville at Con of Thrones. So that's going to be quite a bit of fun. As far as seeing everything you want to see at a con, it's never going to happen. There are so many things happening each hour that you can't possibly go to every panel you want to go to. It's just impossible unless you have a time turner. So, you know, unless you're going to befriend Hermione or sneak into the Department of Mysteries.
That. He's the worst.
Exactly. So just prepare yourself in advance that you're not going to see everything you want to see. In the past, I think that my best tip has been to, find one or two panels every hour or every other hour that you're interested in going to and kind of have your priorities set as to what you would like to see. But plan to do things that aren't on your schedule too. Some of the best things that have happened at cons for me have been going in between the different hall areas and just kind of hanging out with people in between. So I think that just kind of managing expectations of what's possible is the best way to go into a con.
Agreed. Yeah, because I mean, time management really is everything. You have to give yourself time to get from hall to hall. You have to give yourself time to eat, time to use the restroom, time to, hang out with friends and see what you want to see, time to go through the vendor room, because we all know there's a lot of shiny objects in there, and we might get sucked into a booth, and before we know it, it's like February. So
We all turn into Nifflers in the vendor room.
We do, yeah. Yeah, and it's hard to get out of there sometimes. Before you know it, you're like, oh my God, I missed the panel at 1:30 that I really wanted to go see. So it's all about, you know, kind of mapping out what it is that you want to do, and then realistically drilling down that plan and seeing if you're able to do all those things.
And on top of that, as somebody who plans to improvise just like Harry Potter himself, you can do all the planning you want, but at the same time, this is a little bit different than what you were just hearing. Like, have an idea of the things that you care about, but at the same time, be ready to be disappointed because you're not going to see everything that you would want to. Luckily, most of the things that you're going to like or want to see are going to be recorded. You know, that's just what they're going to do. They're going to record it. You can catch it later. Focus on meeting people. Focus on the community aspect.
Networking,
and
yeah.
I think that's something you can't manufacture or replace. And it's not recorded. They're real interactions. They're real people. And you're a real person. Don't let anyone tell you different. You are a real person. And I think that's
important. I'm a real boy.
And huh? I think that's incredibly important to have real boy or real girl interactions with people that are also there as real people. To me, those are the things that you can't get later. It's taking the chance to meet somebody new, taking the chance to sit in the hallway for an extra half an hour and see who walks by and wants to talk about the Cattermoles. Who wants to talk about the Cattermoles? Let's talk about Reg and Mary Cattermole. Hey, take that chance. Be that person. And I don't think you're going to regret it at all. That's my main recommendation, I think, is be that guy that or girl or however you identify and take the chance to meet people and get to know people and how they think in the story about what you like.
We plan, we get there, all hell breaks loose.
Plan to improvise.
Yeah.
This is exactly the quote I was thinking of the entire time we were talking about this.
All right. Well, we'll have another fun segment on next episode, another fun tip for Road to LeakyCon. And in fact, we're going to get with Gretchen and her pack, her con pack idea was really helpful. So we might post that over on hogwartsradio.com so people can, you know, prepare for spending time away from the necessities and just have them on you. All right, let's move on to the wrong answer game. The purpose of the wrong answer game is to answer the question incorrectly. So this one's for the panel. What was the purpose of the vanishing cabinet?
It vanishes your pimples, right?
I don't know. Luke, what do you think?
Everything I thought was not publishable.
Oh, okay.
I struggled. No, I thought it really just, you know, got rid of the weeds in your yard.
I thought it was like your real life Hakuna Matata, you know, put something in there and no worries. No. It's actually the time portal to the Potter multiverse. Which...
Wait, doesn't it like take out the trash for you? It just like vanishes all your junk.
That's the actual purpose, I think.
No, it's actually way more specific than that. It actually just cleans your floors. It's only the junk that is literally like a millimeter thick across your floors everywhere. And if you could just put it in the vanishing cabinet, then you're golden, pony boy.
It's like a Roomba.
So
it's just like a Roomba.
Tile, linoleum, or wood?
Well, it has multiple settings, you see.
Oh, okay.
If you just touch a button, it'll change it. Sorry, the knob on the front, not a button.
Oh, my goodness. And that was the wrong answer game. The next game we're going to play is Tell Me Lies.
it's alright because I love the way you lie. I love the way you lie.
So the purpose of Tell Me Lies is for you to say which character would make a noble order or a nasty Death Eater. The object of the game is to lie, but to make enough sense to be believable. So today's character is Mundungus Fletcher. What do you guys think? Would he make a noble order or a nasty Death Eater? Tell me lies.
Obviously, Mundungus Fletcher is going to make a noble order. He knows the seediest of people, and he can use those relationships with them to get to the bottom of things and uncover the real bad guys of the wizarding world.
No, I fundamentally disagree. I think he would be a pretty seedy Death Eater. And by that, I mean, he's just a dirty, doesn't care about other people at all kind of person. And he's very conceited. He's very much only focused on himself and his own business dealings. And I just feel like he has nothing to offer for the good guys at all.
Well, I am going to have to respectfully disagree. I think he would make a very noble aura. He's always looking out for the greater good. Of course, disapparating with whenever he was with Moody in the Seven Potters chapter. He disapparated because he said, you know what? I can help this cause some other way. And
sure could.
And he said and he said, Moody, you're great, you're an awesome aura. I'm gonna let you, you know, use your lazy boy recliner broomstick here, and I'm gonna disapparate and get out of your hair and take off, and I'm gonna go ahead and go find some magical artifacts to help defeat whatever's going on right now.
You're gonna find somebody to love.
That Mundungus Fletcher, he's such a selfless guy.
He really is, yeah. One of my favorite characters. Too bad he didn't hook up with McGonagall.
What a great combination.
Yeah.
You know? She would have whipped him into shape. And by whipped, I mean physically.
Yeah, yeah. And that is Tell Me Lies. And, guys, I think that does wrap up this week's episode. We want to thank everybody for sticking with us and for tuning in. And does anybody have any, before we get out of here, does anybody have anything they want to plug? Luke, you working on anything? Well, you're always working on something, but is there anything that you want to let everybody know to check out?
Yeah, obviously, the podcast that must not be named are the podcast that.com's Harry Potter podcast. We are cruising to the end of Goblet of Fire. It really does color some of my thoughts for where we are in Must Not Be Named. I'll just say that because that's where I am mentally for story-wise. But we're getting close to the end of Goblet of Fire, and that's been really exciting. Another really fun thing we have coming up very soon for the podcast that drinks and knows things is a role-playing game that we're calling A Game of Ice and Fire. So if you like role-playing games, tabletop gaming, and or A Song of Ice and Fire, there's going to be something that combines all of those wonderful things into a single thing. And hopefully it'll be fun for anyone else. That's what I'm hoping for.
That sounds cool. Can't wait to check that out. Yeah. Yeah. Good stuff. I was kind of worried that Drinks and Nose Things was going away after you guys had finished season 8.
It's definitely not dead. And that's really just the tip of the iceberg. Eventually we'll get into the books. There's also, if you followed the podcast that Drinks and Nose Things through our rewatch, you know that Gertie was our first time watcher. There's also a hint at something that might be coming up called Gertie's Revenge. I'll just say that. Ooh. And there's also a starting today, an idea called the podcast that drinks juice boxes and knows things.
What up?
So, yeah, teasers galore. Yeah, no, you said it best of there's always too much going on in Luke's world, way too much. And the podcast that floats down here is getting very close to the end of Stephen King's It. So if you haven't read it, read it, listen to it. You might enjoy it. It's fun.
That was pretty good. I was trying to think of something fun to say, but no, that was actually pretty good. 10 points to Gryffindor for that. I know you're not.
I'm a Ravenclaw.
I know. I just felt like giving myself house points. Bailey, do you have anything going on? Anything you want to plug?
Oh, one of those projects that Luke did not mention, but is also something that he and I are working on together, is the podcast that gets lit, and it is a literature podcast, like one episode book reviews, basically 1 to 2 episodes. So that is in the pre-production stage and will be coming out hopefully by the end of this year.
A lot of stuff happening over at the podcast, that family of podcasts, and I'm going to leave you with this final teaser. We've survived another episode, and that is it. So we want to thank you so much for tuning in, everyone. Once again, I'm Terrence Pinkston.
I'm Bailey Riddle.
And I'm Luke Hogan.
And we'll see you next time for episode 248. Bye-bye.
That was bloody brilliant. Codswallop.